Hi everyone, my name is Alex. I'm one of the CS168 TAs. This video is meant to make up the discussion that we missed a couple weeks ago in section 11 on multicast and software-defined networking. I'm gonna start by going through the slides that we have for the discussion and then I'll go through the problems. This discussion is mainly centered around multicast, in particular DVMRP and core-based trees or CBTs. And also touches a little on software-defined networking. Since software-defined networking is Scott's area of expertise, I'm going to leave that to him and really just focus on multicasting. So before talking about multicasting, I want to clear up some potential confusion with the different words that we've seen so far. So the first word that should be super familiar is unicast, which we use to describe delivering a packet to one particular host. So usually A wants to send to B, that packet is unicast to B, only sent directly to B. There are these three other terms though that come up, broadcast, multicast, and anycast. The most confusing and the one that we use the least would be anycast, which is delivering a packet to one out of a set of hosts. So if you're sending a packet, maybe there's a set of hosts A, B, C, and D, and you want to send to one of those hosts, and it usually ends up being the closest one. We're not going to talk about that too much in this class. The purpose of that, of anycast, or its main use is in CDNs, content distribution networks, and you can look that up online if you're curious. The other two words that I want to clarify the difference between are broadcast and multicast. So when we broadcast a packet, we send this packet to all hosts on the network. So anyone who's connected will receive this. However, when we multicast a packet, that packet goes to a specific set of hosts on the network. So broadcast goes to everyone, multicast goes to a particular group of friends that you have that you want to receive the packet. And the motivation is this. There are certain situations where the data that you're sending to a bunch of different receivers is completely identical. One very easy example is the Olympic opening ceremony, or I like to talk about the FIFA World Cup. A whole bunch of users want to stream the game, or stream the event. And normal connections are unicast, so each of those users would set up a connection with the server that's hosting the FIFA World Cup, and that server would have to take packets of the game, the actual video packets, and send them off to each receiver. Now, if we were to unicast with each of these receivers, and here in this diagram we have four, for each receiver we have to make a copy of that particular packet and then send it to them. So a whole bunch of bandwidth is used, especially notice on this first link, the closer you are to the sender. There are four copies of identical packet being sent out, the only difference being the destination and the header. And so then this router routes two of the packets to the left and two of the packets to the right. So this link is a little better, in a little better state. And finally, these routers down here route those packets to their destination. All right, so here with four hosts, there's four times the bandwidth required as compared to just sending to one person. But you can imagine with millions of different viewers, this is a big issue. And it just overwhelms the network, especially close to the sender. This is where multicast comes in. So we can change our approach, and now instead of sending a copy of each packet to each destination, we can let the network deal with duplicating the packet. So we just say we're sending to the group of viewers, and then each router will duplicate the packet and send it down whatever links are needed to send to get to all the viewers. So one packet would travel to this router. This router knows that there's some viewers to the right and to the left, so it duplicates the packet and sends one to the right, one to the left that are identical. Same thing with these routers, and everyone gets the packet, and a minimal bandwidth is used. Now, I want to point out that at the end of the day, there's still the same amount of packets at the end of the network. When by the time the packets are actually reaching the hosts, there's still a million copies of the packet. But what's changed is where the duplication happens. So if it were unicast, then the duplication would be done by the host, and the host would make a million copies of that packet and send them all out, try all at once. That would use up a whole bunch of bandwidth. But here, the routers are doing the duplication, and so individual links aren't overwhelmed. So when we're talking about multicast, connections are represented by groups. And we say that a host joins a group with an address G, and senders send to a destination address G. We can talk about multicast in a couple different places. For one, we can talk about it at L2, so Ethernet multicast. We can also talk about L3, which is going to be our IP multicast. We can even talk about app layer, so application multicast, but we're going to leave that out for now. And in this class, focus mostly on L2 and L3. L2 multicast is actually pretty simple because, as you might remember, we already have a pretty nice system in place at L2 that'll adapt itself well. At L2, we don't have all that many hosts. Our network isn't all that big. So we can get away with just broadcasting our packets and letting the host decide if they need them. In particular, we won't say it's not the host itself, but the host's network interface card, the NIC. And so this NIC listens to packets coming in and accepts them if the address that they're addressed to applies to that host. So before, our NICs would only accept packets that were addressed to that host's MAC address or to the broadcast address, all Fs. The only modification we're going to make now is that if a host wants to join a particular group, they just tell their NIC to listen to the address of that group. And now, to join a group, you just tell your NIC to listen to that address. To send to the group, you just send to that address, and it gets broadcast. So from this perspective, you can think of the broadcast address as just yet another multicast group that everyone is part of by default. That's it. It's sort of like a mailing list. So the drawback with this approach is that it's limited to only a single subnet because we're requiring being able to broadcast on a subnet. So this wouldn't work on a bigger system. But we have a huge advantage here in that the state is very minimal. Actually, only the end hosts hold the state. The core network doesn't change at all. L3 multicast is a different story. So here we're going to be multicasting across some different networks. Now, a necessary detail here, how do routers know what addresses are multicast and what are not? There's a particular IP block that's reserved for multicast groups. So 224.0.0.0/4. So anything starting with 1110 is a multicast address. And these multicast groups have open group membership. So anyone can join the group, and they do this by sending an IGMP message. And also any host can send to the group, which seems a little weird, and according to Scott, is a big mistake. Now, there's a couple different kinds of multicast implementations. One is intra-domain, right? So within a single domain. And another is inter-domain, so between different domains in the IP level. We're not going to talk about the inter-domain multicast because it's just a very difficult problem. We're going to focus on intra-domain. In particular, two approaches. One of them, source-specific trees, DVMRP, and the other, a shared tree, which is core-based trees. And you'll have to see these written as CBT. Trees, like that. So for DVMRP, it stands for Distance Vector Multicast Routing Protocol. And really what we get from this name is that this algorithm will leverage the routes that we already have in our forwarding table and use those. So distance vector routing gives us the shortest path from all sources to a destination, right? Because it's destination-based routing. A packet comes in and it's headed for some host A. That packet is sent out of a port that we've computed will give us the shortest path to get to A. So in this way, if you take all of the forwarding state from all of the routers and see where it says to forward packets, you end up building a tree along the way that gives us all of the shortest paths from all of the sources to a particular destination. By thinking of those backwards, right, this tree is also a tree of the shortest path from a source to all destinations, if you just reverse those paths. So this is the very tree that we're going to use. So if some source A is sending to a group with a whole bunch of members, the path that each packet will take from A to the different members will be the same path that a packet would take from the receiving member back to the sender. So how do we actually join the group? To join the group, you send an IGMP message saying, I want to join the group. That goes specifically only to the first hop router. So the moment that someone joins the group, only the first hop router knows about it. The routers learn which are the children in the group. And as we'll see in a second, the rest of the algorithm takes care of it, making sure that router is included in the tree. When a host sends data to the group for the first time, the packets are flooded along this tree, where this tree is the reverse of the unicast paths towards that host. And then the members on that tree, or the routers in that tree, who don't need to be there, prune themselves. So what's up with this pruning? I've convinced you now that we have a way of getting a tree from a source to all destinations, right? It's just the reverse of all the paths from all destinations back to the source. But only some of those destinations are going to be on the tree. So the ones that aren't should try to cut the tree off. We give our children the responsibility to cut themselves off from the tree. So if our child doesn't need to be on the tree, they tell us. If all of our children don't need to be on the tree, then we tell our parent that we don't need to be on the tree. And that's it. We do this by sending a prune message. So it's this NMR message. It stands for non-membership R something. I guess we'll see what it is. But it's a prune message. So in this way, once all of our children have done giving us prune messages, we can prune ourselves or not if one of our children needs to be on the tree. And the result is a tree that connects the source S to all of the receivers in the group. So what state is needed here? Well, there is a different tree for each sender to all of the members of a group, right? So if there are three different senders sending to group one, each of those senders will first have to broadcast and then prune back a tree for the sender group pair, because the path that those packets take depend on the shortest path from all of the destinations back to the source. And since the source changed, now there's a new set of links, and so it's a brand new tree. So DVMRP actually requires a whole bunch of state. For every group, there exists a tree for every source to all destinations. Now those trees aren't built until that source decides to send. But if a lot of people are going to be sending to this group, it's a problem. The state, I also want to point out that I mentioned that the state is stored in the router. And the state that's stored in the router is which groups it sends this non-membership report to about. So if all of its children say that they are not members, then the router marks itself as being not a member. Otherwise, we don't store state. But this is just an implementation detail that's got used in the class. Okay, now we have our core base trees. So for each group G, we choose a particular core. And then the tree is built from all members to that core. Now the requirement here is that every member knows the location of the core in advance. And also you'll see in a second that this core needs to be chosen smartly in advance. So establishing the shared tree, if M1 wants to join the tree, it'll just send a packet to the core, as it did here, right? Just like this. And every router along the way marks down the fact that it's part of this tree and which links are part of the tree. Then M2 wants to join. So M2 will also send a packet to the core, a join packet, but that packet will stop as soon as it's hit a router that's already part of the tree. Because there's no point. As soon as you hit a router that's part of the tree, you are now part of the tree already. Same thing with M3. It wants to join. That's the shortest path. It stops when it hits this router. And now, if M1 wants to send data, it sends data by just flooding it along on this tree. The same way that we had in our L2 protocols. At L2, by running spanning tree protocol, we were able to get a tree that spanned all the hosts on our network. And then we could handle delivery just by flooding. Because as long as every time you get a packet, you flooded out all the other links, that packet won't ever come back to you because they're in a loops. Same exact thing happens here. So M wants to send, it just sends, floods all links that are part of the tree, which brings the packet over here. Then this router floods all links that are part of the tree, other than the one that it just received on. So it goes this way and this way, and so on and so forth. As I mentioned before, the location that you put the core is super important. So if our class is trying to maybe decided somehow Scott has agreed to webcast his lectures, and they're now going to be multicast to all the people in our class. If our core is over in London, but all of us are here in Berkeley, that's not great. Because the tree that gets built will span all the way over to London, right? So we waste a lot of time and a lot of bandwidth potentially. So these core-based trees are nice because they require much less state. There's only a single tree for the whole group. Whereas in DVMRP, there was a tree for every possible sender, or every time a person would send, they would build a tree for them specifically to the group. Here, there's just a single tree marked out for a particular group. Now, to wrap this up, a couple of details that I sort of glossed over. So in DVMRP, you may have noticed that anyone can send to the group. You don't even have to be a member of the group to send. You just do the same exact thing. You end up broadcasting the packet, and then anyone who's part of the group doesn't prune themselves, and anyone who's not does prune themselves, and everything propagates back up the tree, and there we go. You can now broadcast. For core-based trees, if you're not part of the group, then you might have a problem, right? Because the way that these packets are broadcast, or multicast to everyone in the group, is that as soon as the packet hits a router that's part of the group, that packet gets forwarded out, flooded to all the links that are part of that group. But what if your path, because you're not, if you're a member, you're guaranteed that your path to the core is eventually hits the tree. But if you're not in the group, then you're not guaranteed that. So if you want to multicast to that group, you have to encapsulate your packet in another header, a special header, send it to the core, and then the core will send it to everyone in the group. Then there was one other thing I wanted to talk about with DVMRP. Oh yeah, so how we actually go about implementing DVMRP. So in DVMRP, we can build this tree. I think I gave a convincing argument for where the tree comes from before we start pruning it in DVMRP. And I said that it comes from the combination of all of the shortest paths, the paths that we would use to unicast a packet from each receiver to the sender. Combining all of those paths together gives us our tree that we're going to use for multicasting in DVMRP. How can we actually come up with this tree programmatically? Well, when the sender is A, sends the packet out to the group, every router along the way will flood the packet, but to only use links that are on the path back to the source, we'll have each router ignore packets that come in on a link other than the one that they would use to get to A. So the result is that we only accept packets to send out to people with multicast on the link that we use to reach the sender. So this way, the link that we would use to get to the sender is what ends up being on the tree, which is exactly what we're trying to do. We're trying to include the links that we would use to get from the destination back to the source. So that is everything I'm going to say on multicast. Really, these main topics here are DVMRP and core-based trees. And now you can go on to the problems and follow along as I do them with you.